Professor Chai, would you kindly introduce our speaker to the audience, please?
Yes. Thank you, everyone, and welcome to the next of the talks in Hoshe Conversations. Today we have with us Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh, who is one of the finest painters in the country today and has been for some time. His work has inspired not just appreciation, but also discussions about some of the fundamentals of life in our country. Sheikh Saab is a painter, and he's also a writer, and he writes poetry in Gujarati. He writes essays also, and his recent books in Gujarati are perhaps the most important books on the aesthetics of painting that have been written in Gujarati in many, many years. I would say this is path-breaking work. And he was, of course, at the Faculty of Fine Arts in Baroda, but he was also part of this dynamic group of thinkers, poets, painters, critics, who formed that little nucleus of intense activity in Baroda. He still continues to live in Baroda, but also travels and meets people all over the country, except that now with coronavirus, for the moment, he is stationed. Ghulamji, we are really very, very happy to have you here and to see your work and your paintings and your what you want to say about them. Most welcome.
Well, this at this point, particularly when you invited me to come and speak to you all in this particular webinar that you have held since last few days, I thought that since it is basically a group of architects, I should speak about my involvement or engagement with the city and show you some of the paintings that I have been doing. Now, it all started around the time when I returned from England in 1966. And I went home. That means I went to my hometown called Surendranagar in Saurashtra. And I was struck by some of the things that I saw there. I was away for about 3 years, and when I returned, I found many things still present in the same form that I had left them. But there were many changes which had taken place that gave me a kind of a, or rather it provided me with some ideas, and I thought that I should write them down. And I wrote this down in Gujarati. It's called Gher Jata, that means going home. Now it took about 15 years when I returned to the same idea, when I was painting a series of paintings for an exhibition called Place for People. And six artists had come together and we were showing it in Bombay and Delhi. So I showed four paintings there. I'm sharing you one of the paintings which I showed there. Now, can you show the first painting? It's called Speaking Street. In a way, it goes back to the times of my childhood. Roughly speaking, you can see a young boy standing on the left, and there is a street which opens up in front of him or us. So, but my idea was to open up the place or the space as much as possible. That means both inside and outside. So what is going on in this street is visible, as you can see. Somebody, a man is beating a woman. There is another where they are sitting. He's sitting with a woman. People are playing cards. Somebody is walking inside. And there is this green building, which is actually a mosque. And you can see women selling fish outside the mosque. And then beyond that, you can see that some event is taking place where there are two winged creatures. Now the basic idea, the way I saw my childhood, was in a way reimagining it. In a sense, it is also not just memorizing, because memorizing or memorializing or whatever you call it would be nostalgia. And I did not want to become nostalgic about a place that I had left behind. So in a way, it is also creating memory. So that memory is a new construct. And that allowed me to do a series of paintings. Well, I did not dwell upon just one painting, but one simple aspect that I would draw your attention to is that the mosque doesn't have a dome. It doesn't have, it has minarets, but they are tiny minarets. And let me tell you that when I returned to my hometown some 30, 40 years later, I found that the mosque had changed. And then mosque had a kind of a minar, which was not there in my childhood. So that meant that times have changed, so in reality also it has changed. But this is how I imagined and I painted. So in one sense, it is an attempt to enter into some space. The space that I partially belong to, and the space that I am creating for myself. And this is what has engaged me for a number of years. Can we go further? Next. It was around 1975-76 when I began this canvas, actually, but that canvas had a fleeing figure, a man running away with multiple hands. And it was the time of the emergency. And as the painting developed in the 2 years, it continued. I must have scribbled it here and there and changed a few things, but eventually I changed this into this. I changed it into this particular kind of a, whatever you call it, a landscape. And it is a kind of a place where it is speechless. And I called it Speechless City. That was a speaking street, and this is a speechless city. So I thought there was something that I was here dealing with speech, you know, human speech. Or in a way it is human presence. And here it is marked by the absence of the human being. I was quite happy to show it during that period of time in Delhi in a gallery called Black Partridge, which was a part of Haryana Tourism Corporation, and very strangely, nobody saw the reference that I was making to the speechlessness that had affected the lives of people during the emergency. Anyway, this is the third one, if you could please open the third painting. So I was This is a painting, the one that I showed you right in the beginning, called Speaking Street. This is a companion piece of that painting. I saw them together and I made them and felt that they should work together, not that they have remained together. One painting is in Bhopal, this one is in London. But that's another story. What I wanted to grapple with here was the city that I lived in. That was the town that I had lived in my childhood. And this is the city of Baroda that I was living in. You might have known that Baroda has got the dubious distinction of being a kind of a riot city. It had numerous communal clashes. And I know at one period of time, this is sometime around 1981. And I had seen a news item that in a year, one of those years, Baroda had the maximum number of riots in the country. Well, that's another thing, but how do you bring that in, you know, in your work? So this was imagined to be a city viewed through people. So you have different kinds of people. So first, let me talk about these three men who are standing in front. This is an archway, 7 foot high and 10 foot wide. So these people are roughly of the size of about 5 feet. In other words, if you stand in front of the painting, you would perhaps recognize them as being in front of you. And I'm using kind of a language which is sort of more naturalistic, more realistic language, so that you connect with them. So these are the people in the street who meet for a match. And they are from different social backgrounds. But what I meant to say was that the match has an incendiary element, and that incendiary element is visualized in other terms. For instance, as you go on top, there is a riot raging. I will show you a detail of it a little later, but I'm just telling you that. And then the people who are falling out from that, you know that tumultuous riot that is going on, and then the town and a woman who has got a kind of a, what we call a lari, that means a little hand cart, and in which she sells vegetables. And then right in the center, I'm placing a painter who is making the eyeball of a cinema actress, in this case, Rekha, who was one of the characters in a film called Silsila. And it was a purely commercial venture in which our matinee idols used their own, whatever, life or gossip of their life, you know, into a kind of a money-making project. Now, what is interesting is that in Baroda, at that time, I remember that when I was painting, where the riots were raging in one part of the city, in other part of the city, the cinema, that particular film was being screened without any disturbance. So what is a city for that matter? It's not homogeneous. It has many aspects. In fact, in one city, there are a number of worlds. So in a way, what I was attempting was to bring in as many worlds as possible in order to construct a city, the city that I lived in or the city I knew, and city I had, actually I had lived there for more than 20 years by that time. Now I'll show you some details of this painting. If you go further, next. Yes, please show the next. So this is the center of the painting where a scene from Silsila is being screened in a cinema hall. As you can see, that cinema hall is seen from both outside as well as inside. And then there are other characters which I need not describe. Next. Next, please. Can you go? So this is the scene on top, the kind of, it's as I described it, the scene of a riot in which a man is being denuded in order to ascertain whether he is circumcised or not. And that was one of the characters of the riots that took place in Gujarat. Next. Well, I have come to another place. Well, I've been, in a way, doing this kind of painting, and then something else came my way. It was actually architect Charles Correa who got in touch with me, and in fact, explained to me that he has designed the new assembly, legislative assembly for the state of Madhya Pradesh in Bhopal. And he wanted to have artists contribute. And he also had asked, I remember he had asked there was a tribal artist called Jangad Singh Sham, who had already painted the front of the building. And he offered me a space which is about 31 feet high and 21 feet wide. This is an entrance of the upper house of the legislative assembly. So I said yes, and I was surprised that very strangely, even the government officers, there's one gentleman called Mr. Butch, he also seemed to be very happy and interested in my undertaking that project. So I undertook that project, although there was some problem about the time, and they said that it should be finished within 6 months. I said, I can't promise you, but I will try. And in fact, we did finish it within a little over 6 months. And then, can you show the next one? So I was not too sure whether this would be given as a project to somebody to mount it. The painting was done on 13 different panels, and these panels were sort of fitted with clamps. And then we had the negative and positive clamps, and we prepared a wooden structure on the wall. And then we laid out from top to bottom, and we ourselves actually with a set of friends like my friend Naji Patel, who unfortunately he's no more now, but we actually mounted it ourselves. So it was for us a kind of an engineering of sorts. Anyway, next. So you can see it from the side. If you are somewhere on the balcony opposite or on a higher sort of space somewhere there, that it has a door. That door is actually meant for the legislators to enter. So I had thought of using that door, and I even got parts of that door painted. In fact, we got the whole door constructed and we got everything painted. We even designed the handle. Anyway, next. So this is the mural, which is in 13 parts. As you can see, there are, at the bottom, there are three squares. The middle square is the door. On the left, there is a square. On the right, there is a square. And there is a little aside. I may tell you that we had to cover it with glass. One of the reasons was not because people might touch it, but also because I was told that the legislators are very fond of palm. And they are, you never know, you know, when somebody might just spit a palm on it. But anyway, so it was actually, the idea was to have, you see, for a long time I had nurtured this desire to paint a life-size tree. But how can you paint a life-size tree? So this is how eventually it came out. But before making this, I had made three maquettes, and the final work. And so in a way, it's a kind of a, what you call, microcosm of the country that we are living in. So it's not just a city, but it is multiple cities, multiple places. So as I was saying, in even the previous other painting, that what I was trying was to bring in as many. So I was showing you the lower part of the mural and the tree in the middle, the tree trunk, and then there are images. I was describing you one man speaking to birds and animals. This comes from Katha Sarit Sagar. But anyway, I will not dwell upon all these things. I will continue further, and for you to have a good grasp of the work itself, and then we can proceed further. I have one more image of the middle of the mural, which you can see here. This is the middle part, which is the, you know, the city or cities, you know, all joined in, you know, with the mosques and the temple and the houses and people, including the, I don't know whether you can make out, right at the top on the left, the flying figure. Just above the flying figure, there is the building, which is actually the building in which the mural is situated. So I have painted the building that Korea designed inside this painting. Anyway, can we go further? Now, this is also one of the city paintings. And this, I do not know whether you can make art because it's rather dark. But I call it City of Statues. Now, we seem to have a fetish about statues. And we sometimes give, consider them more important than the human beings. So our statues are scattered all around. Sometimes they are the heroes, sometimes they are all kinds of characters, sometimes questionable characters, they are all there. And there is a woman there right in the center, you know, who is sort of shouting at a crowd that is coming in front of it, you know, which is very difficult to see in this image, which is a small image, unless you are watching it on a larger computer. But I'll show you the next painting, which is which will give you a better idea about the city that I painted. This is a large city that I painted, 24 feet wide, and roughly from top to bottom, including the semicircle, to be about 20 feet. So it has got both sculpture as well as painting. You know, there are these small figurines which are on the bottom. So in a way, it is City of Baroda. And this City of Baroda, we wanted to visualize. In fact, there is a side story that I was invited for an exhibition in Shanghai, a number of artists were invited and I painted this for that exhibition. So anyway, there is also a reference of Yuan Sang, but I will not dwell upon it. But so in a way, you know, what we did was to actually look at Google Earth. So Google Earth provided us with a kind of, the city from seen from the satellite. And we saw this city, our own city in which we were situated. And we literally gasped because we had never seen the city in the manner in which it emerged in front of us, when we saw it. So we tried to get as many high resolution images as possible. And then eventually settled on a middle part of the city. And then, you see what we did was to, I planned it a kind of, it's kind of slightly curved. So there are six canvases, all mounted on board, but they are slightly curved. Each one is curved. So it makes a sort of a semicircle and then it spills down and then it literally flows and then ends in a semicircle. So roughly speaking, the old city is in front on flat and the new city is at the bottom. The new city has some kind of visitors, maybe the visitors who had lost their habitats and have come to reclaim them. But the city on the top, I'll show you a detail, please. Next, please. I don't know if you can make out. So it is, we had this, a kind of a overview of the city from the Google Earth. And what we did was to actually freely draw the arteries of the city, the roads and the, some of the lanes, not every thing as it was, but maintaining a basic structure of the city. And within that, we then began to imagine our own city. We painted houses. I had a number of assistants who were working with me, and I had sent them out in the city to take photographs of all kinds of buildings and people and everything. And they came back, and some of these we used here. And then I thought that I will not be using much of the statues that I had used in a previous painting, but I'm making these little statues, which I made in papier-mâché. By the way, the whole canvas in this particular case was literally sort of applied with papier-mâché, and we, so in a way, papier-mâché is one of the medium which attracted me, and we began to draw with a dry crayon, and we drew house by house as though we were building the city. So we went from place to place, as to say, and it sort of literally kind of not only recovering the city, but also building the city, making the city visible. And in many ways, it did not have anything to do with the city that there was, you know, in physical terms, but we were building the city based on the same structure that we had obtained from Google Earth. And then we planted images into them. There are images of violence, there are images of a sweeper there. Actually, the idea that I had beside Chinese Connection, what I planned the city was that if the city has been consistently ravaged from time, again, time and again, I wanted to bring forth images of people who are daily wages or people who work on the sidewalks. There is a man who repairs your bicycle, somebody who repairs your umbrella, So there are all kinds of people who lose their, you know, livelihood when violence erupts in the city. And this particular one also shows it on the right. I don't know, even there is some reference to the riots in Baroda. So this was for me a kind of a way in which I could encompass the city. I don't know whether I would say embrace because it's too large, but I would perhaps see that this city is something which I can see from a tweet, though it is not actually from a tweet as actual city is. It is a city which I have construed, I have actually made. And this is something which gave us, you know, it took a great deal of time. We worked day and night, and we built it structure by structure, point by point, house by house, street by street, and eventually this is what it emerged into. Now this is one city called Baroda. I have a very long title about it. It's called City, and which has got references of all kinds, you know, like imaginings, like memory, like return of the ghosts, and so many other things, which I, it's a subtitle, but basically it is called City. And it is painted in casein. Casein is a medium which is milk-based, and it is actually organic. And so with I used raw canvas, then we applied it with a pulp of papier mache over the canvas, and then drew in a dry crayon and dry pastel, and then a kind of watercolor, and then we laminated it. Anyway, this is the city. Can you go to the next one? I don't know whether you can make out. But this is another big city. I had always been fascinated by the city of Ahmedabad, which I have, you know, I have not lived in Ahmedabad, but I've seen it hundreds of times. And I, right from my childhood, I used to go there. I used to find it fascinating, not only its, you know, architecture or buildings, but both old and new, but also the way in which it's a kind of a maze. That maze which is literally sort of all over you, you know, it takes over you. The city literally, you know, takes you on your fold and literally sort of throws you from one corner of the street to the another, and you keep walking. By the way, walking is my hobby horse. I have been always walking right from my childhood. I didn't even have the chappal side, as far as I remember, in the early days. But I always found spaces of the city or the town that I was in through my feet, but also with your eyes, with your hands, that you literally go into the city, into, in whichever way you put it, you know, into the belly of the city, or into the, you know, veins of the city, or into the heart of the, wherever. But, so in a way, roughly speaking, if you see the big form that arises out of it, it's a bit of a, something like a heart. And that the city opens, and you have right in the middle an opening. That's the only opening in this painting, is a lane, what we call a pole, that inside the pole, the sky is visible. The sky is not anywhere. Everything is covered by buildings of various sorts. And on top, of course, I suppose everybody knows that it is also, it refers to the communal flagration that took place both in Baroda and Ahmedabad, particularly in 2002. And here I have brought in a variety of people who are sort of walking about, you know, that there is no known personality. They are all nameless people, you know, you do not know. They are men and women. Sometimes the woman who cleans your street. But at the same time, this city of Ahmedabad, has been very closely linked to Gandhiji. Gandhi has been a main inspiration in this particular painting, and that's why I call this painting The City Gandhi Left Behind. So I saw it on Google Earth, and I found that part of the city, which is in a way old part of the city, and at the bottom you see the which is not visible here, but it is the river, that is Sabarmati River. And if you were able to recognize some of the building where the Satyagraha movement, that means it started, there is the Dandi March which began there. There is also the Hriday Kunj, the place where Gandhiji lived. But I will come to that. What I want to show you, and particularly my architect friends, is how I construe the structure of buildings inside the city. If you can see the black and white, you know, gray and white, if you can make out, you know, this whole, you know, a whatever you call it, it's not a mosaic. It's actually a kind of coming together of all kinds of buildings, all kinds of people and buildings together, woven into each other. And that was the intention, that this is what, so some who are outside, you know, as they are shown there, but there are those who are actually woven into the very structure of the building. You know, they are part of the building. Many of them must have been those who built those cities. They must have been masons, or they must have been workers, etc., etc. And I wanted to bring them in. I don't know whether it's visible, but if you see the actual painting, you may be able to see them. And then comes the image of Gandhi. Now, can I go a little further? Next one. Yes? Can we go further? Yeah, I do not know whether you can make out, but this is what I'm trying to show you, that these are the buildings on the right in which there are images of men and women. They are woven into those gray and white forms. But then there are all kinds of things. Now there are also references to various parts of Ahmedabad, but I will not dwell on that. What I show you is how the city is construed. So, you know, you may even see the Rani Sipri Mosque, but there is a man on a bicycle. There are all kinds of things which are coming into it. But I would like you to focus on the left bottom. I do not know whether you can make out, there is a watch, it is the watch that Gandhi had with him. He used to keep this kind of a watch. So when I thought that this was the city where Gandhi had actually built his ashram, he had lived there. And if you remember that when the Dandi Yatra, the whole procession, the going to Dandi, that event that happened, you know, to literally combat the mighty arm of the colonial rule or oppressor, Gandhi had vowed that he will not return to Ahmedabad until independence is achieved. So for me, this is very important. So I quoted both the place from where Dandi Yatra took place. I also quoted the building where he lived. But I have also quoting the few things that he left behind. So if I may go further, if this is not visible, I'll show you a couple of details. Next, please. Well, this is a detail which you can see, but I do not know whether you can make out at the bottom, because the watch is still visible, but other things are not. So we can proceed further. Can you go next? Well, this is the scene which I had already shown you, so I will not dwell upon this. But what I want to show you next, please. Next. Well, this is the clock. This is the little watch that he had. What he left behind is a watch, I think, and perhaps a copy of Bhagavad Gita, perhaps, and also his spectacles, and the cover of his spectacles. And the last image, can you please move? That what he left behind was, yes? Can we go further? What is interesting is that it's a plate and a bowl. It's very significant that Gandhi left behind these three or four things, which occurred to me quite, in some ways, very representative as well as symbolic. The spectacles, as though the streets, the world, the cities, etc., that he saw and, in a way, made us to see. The watch, I think he was very conscious of the time, not physical, but time in every sense of the word, the time in which you live and how you respond to that time. And the last was this plate and a bowl. Now here it is, an empty plate and an empty bowl. Now I think what he had in mind, you know, I'm trying to sort of read more meaning into that. It is someone who has gone to bed hungry. It is something which has no food. It's devoid of its substance. So Gandhi left us with a legacy of these four or five things that he left behind. And in a sense, the city for me is summed up by these objects. And especially the people who built that city and the people whom we see day in and day out, but those who rarely figure. So I construed this city and I suppose you will have lots of questions about why and how I did this. And I shall be happy to answer some of them if I can. Thank you. Gone again. Shall I open the participants? Are there? Start video is there.
Yeah, and you could start your video. Yes.
Participants?
Yes, we can see you.
Stop video and start video. Yes. Hey, start video. Why is it going? Oh, no. Yeah.
Yes, it's back.
Is it okay? There I am. Okay.
Sheikh Sahib, your cities were packed with, as you said, many worlds.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow they were also sort of pushing each other or bending each other. As if that though they were, each world was complete, but it was also trying to affect the other world. Is it something like that? Have I understood reasonably?
What other world do you have in mind?
No, all those worlds. You said that the city is many worlds.
Yeah.
And I was thinking in the paintings, in each painting, one world was complete in itself in some way, but it was pushing the space of the other one, each one, somehow or other.
Well, in a way, if I were to interpret what you are saying, each world was jostling with the other.
Yeah.
I have no problem with that.
Yes.
I think that's a welcome interpretation, because the world in which we live is a world in which each one is jostling with the other. So if that is the way, but what is further intended is that I want also to show that multiple worlds can be aligned, can be together. Multiple worlds not necessarily homogeneous. The worlds which are in whatever form in body are different, and yet they are together. So in a way, that multiplicity or being together, in a way, in interaction, sometimes in even violent interaction with each other, but at the same time existing simultaneously and finding a voice. And that is what I hope, if it comes through.
The other question that arose is that in that beautiful painting of Baroda, the old city is on the wall and the new city is on the floor. And on the new city, it looked like mostly roads, and you didn't apply papier mâché there to make the buildings. On the other one, there is so much richness. Even though fine arts faculty, I think, is the Vishwamitri is just at the bottom of that canvas. No?
It's at the crossroads.
Yes. Yes.
So faculty is at the crossroads.
Crossroads, yes. So now, this sense, is there a sense of comparison in the composition, the three-dimensional composition between the two?
What I tried to do was to paint the old city. That means using paint. Basically, with the bottom is also slightly projected, that is built with paper mache. The ground is actually built with structures which are projected above.
Oh.
On top of them are those little figures, which are also made in paper mache. In some ways, the older city is more, what shall we call, organic, or shall I use such a word? In a way, each form, each house grows out of the other, and it gives birth to other houses, and they multiply, and they make the city. So it's in that sense, there is an organicity, which is part of it, and then the streets, etc., also become part of it, it's also you enter into those areas. But at the bottom, it's rather flat. It's rather geometric, and it is rather harsh. It's not that organic as top parts are. In some ways also, if you wish to reflect on it, you know, you said that older cities really get the brunt of everything. If something happens to it, it usually happens in the old city. If you live in the old city, you have to face the music, no? Because anything happens, it will happen there. And then you have to wriggle your way out. Mm-hmm. So the life in the old city is quite different than the life in the new city. In the new city, you feel secured. You have your whatever, four walls which will cover you, and you don't really face. You sometimes, you know, as I was saying in that painting called The City for Sale, that where on the one hand you have the raging riots, on the other you have the cinema where people are sitting and watching a film like Silsila. So there is that kind of a security, you know, which is built in that. But this is the only superficial comparison. Mm. What I wanted to show was that if the city is a body, that body has many arteries, many parts, many limbs. It doesn't necessarily like a human body, but it is suppose if it is a body, then it has all those, you know, parts which function differently. And they also, like for instance, how many times when you go to get yourself photographed, you have your bottom part of the body photographed. You photograph yourself from the top to the middle. It's only the top and the middle. You know, I'm giving a very simplistic example, but just to make a point that city is in a way a body which functions, body that lives, and in which there are these multiple forms, multiple formulations, and we in there, you know, allow those multiple formulations to take place, and we become part of it. We are also part of it. So in that sense, I am not outside the city. It is a city which in a sense is within me, like as it is in a body, but also I am outside the city and observing it. So between the two, you know, there is a space. The space is the dark space. It's a space nobody can define. You know, you always try to enter through that space, and that keeps changing all the time. Looking at the city, every time, even if you look at your body, it looks different. The city in that sense looks so different. And all your formulations, you know, come back to you and you see, my God, what's this? I don't know what to make sense of it. I wanted to get close to that kind of a befuddling, you know, that aspect, the city that makes you totally, you know, lost. I'm not talking lost in the sense of walking inside. Yes, of course you walk into it, because I construe the city in which you can walk, because the city is made for walking, it's meant for. But at the same time, the city grabs you, and that you are in it without, you know, your dialogue is always in a kind of a space, which is very, very difficult to articulate, very difficult. So what can a painter do? Painter can only paint, no? Painter can start a dialogue somewhere, whether it is a big dialogue or a small dialogue. I have done smaller paintings also, but this was something which was, which came as a big challenge to me. Yeah.
Thank you
for asking that question.
Thank you for showing us the paintings. That is fantastic. Yes. Yep. No, thank you.
Sir, I have a question for you. With the multiplicity that you were talking about, and yes, the different cities jostling together or different lives jostling together, what is the sense of the overall composition? What is, how does one get, or how does one get to the overall composition? What is the nature of forming that? When, if it is like this, because from a monotonous city or a city which is, which has a single form, then you can think of a larger whole. How is the whole formed in this?
I will answer it in a couple of different ways. Would it be okay? You see, this city, even if you see it on Google Earth, doesn't have very clear outlines. Now, somewhere the city enters into the farmland, somewhere it enters into another town or a small town, somewhere it connects with some big open space, etc., etc. So if you want to draw an outline over the city and say, ah, this is what it is, city would tell you that perhaps you are mistaken, that it's not. The city means what? It's a constantly growing organism. No. Today, you take these outlines, and in 10 years' time, those outlines will have to change, you know, because the city has grown. Now, that brings me to the main issue, that the city doesn't grow from outside. The city grows from inside. And as I was saying in the morning, if you were there, if you were to imagine a movement which is from inside outward, suppose you have, you just imagine a lane or a street or a square, and then, so in a way what happens is that the city, if you take that part, it grows around. So there are multiple points around which the city grows. It continually keeps growing, and there are similar points at which, you know, it expands. So its basic view, basic purpose is to grow bigger, bigger and bigger. Perhaps in the case of New York, it is higher, but also bigger and bigger. Now, when you grow bigger and bigger, obviously, you know, when there is no planned city, but if it's, I would say, if it is a city which has been visualized in certain terms and let people to make it grow, many of the cities are made by people, you know. That means, you know, you may not like it. You may think that it is, it's not, it doesn't follow a system. It breaks, it moves in this direction, and there it moves in another direction, here it. And you have all kinds of forms which your art school or architecture school have given to you, and you see that they are all thrown to bits. And here it goes helter-skelter. But actually, when people live in that, what you call helter-skelter, it comes to life. And the life is made by people living in them. And hence the building extends further. A balcony would come out from somewhere where you don't imagine. Architect may would say, no, it should not have been there. It should have, it's not the right place. But if you were to think of such cities, and many cities in our country, are the cities which are actually created by people. You know, they are not the city. In some cases, like Mughal city of Fatehpur Sikri or some such cities where you have a plant. But most of the plant cities have not functioned the way. Even Chandigarh, for that matter, you know, has not functioned the way the markets in Chandigarh have grown. Totally against the views of our Corbusier. They are, in a way, making all the grids that Corbusier has brought in into some kind of a, you know, disarray. And you would find that, ye kya ho raha hai? But what you call, which is a kind of a, how do you describe that? That is, you say it is, you know, some of you might even say that it's mindless, you know, you just, it comes to your head and you do it. But you say nothing is mindless in this world. Everything has a purpose. When you build a balcony where you think it should not be there, it has a purpose. And that purpose is established by living there and using that balcony. And that balcony then assumes a meaning which you never imagined. So in that sense, you know, the city grows from inside outwards. And hence this multiplicity is the very character of the city. It cannot be homogeneous. By per se, it cannot be homogeneous. It can't be. You can't design a city. I'm sorry to say, I'm with all due regards to Mr. Corbusier and Mr. Louis Kahn and all of them. I am a great admirer of them. They are great, great minds and they were great architects. They did wonderful things. At the same time, if I have few ideas, you know, which militate against the planned cities, I'm not speaking against school of architecture, I'm sorry. I'm saying that there is something which is planned and which is unplanned. And these unplanned cities have also given us a kind of a view of life, which has made us rethink about whatever that we have planned. But if you have questions further, please ask.
No, sir, the sense you're saying is coming out really well, even in the paintings, like Silsila or the Ahmedabad painting, you're saying that from the center it emanates. That is quite clear that the center catches your attention. But then if you start looking at the parts of the painting, they have their own center, they have their own attention too. And then you get lost in a painting, you get lost in this multiplicity. So that came out really well there. Thanks for answering.
But there is no one center, my dear.
Yes, yes. Yeah, that was quite.
There are multiple centers.
Yeah.
And smaller things become bigger. Smaller centers assume bigger proportions. Let me give you an example. And I'm giving you an organic example, not a example of a whatever you call a geometric kind. Imagine a banyan tree. A banyan tree grows so vast, as you must have seen many banyan trees. But banyan tree throws its roots down into the earth around it. And those take roots and then become trunks. So there will be multiple trunks, and at times, you know, if you ever go to a place called Kabirwad near Bharuch, you know, you would not be able to find out which is the original trunk and which is the trunk which has come out of it. So you have growth happening from inside outward and continuing. But that is a circular growth. The city doesn't grow in a circular manner. City may grow in multiple directions, in multiple ways, and in multiple forms. And that is what makes it fascinating. And I think there's no city like Ahmedabad anywhere. Unfortunately, we have not been able to save it as much. Mr. Vasavada is sitting there, and I know, I fully, totally sort of, you know, understand the concern that he has shown. But that's why I say that in that sense, we should allow cities to grow. We should plan, we should design, yes, of course. But at the same time, you know, we should have the larger kind of a way in which, you know, it can organically develop. Anyway, it's a bigger issue. I need not go into that. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Any more?
I have two questions, if I may.
Please.
In continuation with what Vignesh was saying, you know, there is, and also the Baroda painting, which has got a very clear two distinct halves. One is the lived city, and the other is a thought out, conceived, or planned city. And one is organic, like you pointed out, the other is intellectual. But there is a third kind of a layer on both. And that layer I find is one of kind of a madness. And I don't want to use madness in a pathological way, but a kind of a creative madness, which is part of a, it seems like a part of the lived city, but becomes a kind of an obsession when it becomes part of an intellectual city. So that madness takes a different kind of a form. I wonder if you had any thoughts on that. And I had a second question. Maybe I can say.
Let me answer the first one.
Okay.
Did you mean madness or badness?
Madness. Madness. Like.
I am a great votary of madness. You see, all artists are, in a way. And I would include Mr. Doshi in them. You know, how he talked about his childhood, you know, without clothes and enjoying the rain. No, but that apart, you know, you are right that there is a kind of a madness. But if I may use the oft-used idiom called Mazarin madness, there is always something within that binds it together. Okay, you have, you know, buildings which are ugly. Which are ugly means that those which appear ugly to us because we have idea of beauty, and those things which we do not consider according to our taste, and we call them ugly. But if these are there, and then suppose there is a jhopadpatti, you know, how people build jhopadpattis. You know, basically it is a human need. And how the human need allows you to grow. So you build, you construct, you extend, you cover, you do various things, you know, by which you bring everything. You know, you have a, you know, if it is, you cannot afford to have the material that those who build that, you know, houses, you know, have. You know, so you, whatever material that is available to you, you use it. If there are few bricks lying there, you use them. If the bricks are not there, you put a tin sheet. You put plastic cover on it and you do all kinds of things, you know. All kinds of mad things that you can imagine, you know, that you will see in Dharavi or you would see in many of the jhopadpattis. What is interesting, and this morning Mr. Doshi was also speaking about something else, but it comes to me and at this point of that everything is related to the need of the hour, that particular people living in that particular shack have this much need. Suppose if there are 10 people and the shack is perhaps 5x5 or 5x6 or 8x8, how would you? You don't even have a space to sleep. Where would you find them? But they do. And you and I know that they do. And I remember my old memory. At one point of time, when I used to go to Bombay, I used to see people sleeping on the roads. And I used to see hundreds and thousands of them. And then I would see people in the train, and I would see that this, and then every time I look at where do these people go, where do they find their place? But everybody finds their place either on the road or in the shack or in the house there, which means space is elastic. Space is made elastic by human need. Human beings make the space. You know, they push the walls of the shack as with their own hands, as to say, and make it sleepable for 10 people, you know, and 10 people live there. You know, they make a little, whatever, you know, bunker or whatever it is, but they do, they, you know, how people live there. Now the thing is this madness. I would think that madness is part of all creation. Madness is part of, in some ways, you know, you have to be totally outside this whatever world that you exist, and you have to find some area where you exist and where you want to make it. You want to, whatever you want to write, you want to paint, you want to do that, you know. I would say that one such mad architect was Nari Gandhi. I don't know whether you know about him and whether his work is being taught in art schools of architecture. But it's interesting, this man was, I went to see one of his buildings in Mud Island. I don't know whether you know that. That building he built by his own hands. He broke pieces of furniture. He broke bottles. He broke tin sheets. He broke stones. And in a way, it's one of the buildings which I saw, which has got an arch. It would be something like 30-foot arch. How would it stand on its own, my dear? And it's not a straight arch. It's a horizontal arch. And it's amazing how, so I mean, where this man, and everybody thought, ye mar jayega, is par ye sab girega, ye ko hone wala nahi hai. That man managed. I'm not saying that that is the best thing in the world, but I'm giving an example of certain kind of madness, you know, that allows you to enter into territories, enter into areas, which, let us say, all your reason may not. No, reason may perhaps have all kinds of reasons to counter. You are countering everything that, but you see the madness doesn't have reason. No, madness somewhere goes in an area, but it may strike somewhere. So if somebody like a poet like Rambo, if he disappears from the civilized world and goes to Africa, takes a boat and drowns and dies, it may happen to many, you know. It happened to many artists also. But I'm not saying that it should befall all of us. But the thing is that somewhere the seed of that madness should remain alive. And without that seed of madness, perhaps what you do is all. Yeah. I don't. Yeah, you have a second question. Have I answered the first?
Yes, you have. In a way.
If I'm not, I'll try again.
No.
But ask me.
I think it's good to leave some things to imagination. And I think that was part of my second question, was that, you know, you are a poet. You're also clearly very articulate about the thoughts that go behind each painting. And my question to you was, how do you stop yourself from actually making your paintings very literal by almost like putting poetry into the painting? Because I'm sure there's a temptation to write into the painting, and a lot of artists also do. They write within their paintings. And is that something that you consciously do to kind of leave things open-ended, or is it something that...
Look, I tell you very frankly, when we paint, all the verbiage that I have made in front of you did not exist. You see, after a painting is done, you are outside it. You are an outsider. You look at it as though it, because it is own entity, you know, it is coming to existence. It's there, you know. And there you can look at it from multiple points of view, you know, whether you have any interpretation, you may, it not necessarily was part of your mind at that point of time, not necessarily part of your creative endeavor at that point of time, not necessarily it was part of your journey. Possibly some of it was, but not all of it. Many things emerge after it is done, it is finished. Because at one level, and I've said it before, no painting is ever finished. Paintings do not get finished. You can go from painting to painting. You see, each painting leads to another painting, which means, you know, you continue. In a way, it's a bit like singing as a rag, you know, you sing. And you stop it because there is a need to stop, because you can't stop, you can't sing for that long. But then it, same rag, if the musician sings again, let's say 20 days later or 2 years later or 5 or 20 years later, he picks up from where he left. And he enters into that world again. And he recreates that world. He's not creating the same thing. He recreates. What I was trying to say with regard to my memory was that we are creating memory. It's not the memory. Memory is nostalgic. Hence, anything that is literal, if there is an explanation, if that is literal, you should cast aside. If it helps you in any way in understanding that particular work, well and good, but not beyond that. Anything literal, you must try to find if there is any imagination. I think literal description does a lot of harm. I perhaps must have made the mistake of explaining to some of the paintings, thinking that perhaps you are not aware of this painting. But that was my mistake, not yours. So please don't go by that. Now look at it afresh with your own mind and see how it works upon you, not me, not because of my words. Provided it interests you, and if it interests you, you will perhaps ask question and you may also find your own answer. Have I made myself clear?
Yes, yes, you have.
Okay.
There are many questions asked by the attendees. If I could take one of them one by one, or would the panelists like to ask something? Professor Vasavana, please. Yeah.
Can I ask a question, Sandeep?
Please do.
Please.
Most welcome.
Well, it was wonderful looking at your work. And it was also wonderful to see Surendranagar in your work. Because I think we have the same sort of native, you know, afflictions. The other thing which you also mentioned, and it did appear that way, that the Bhopal work was one of your most significant works. And I think that was an earlier work, because I remember when you were doing this, I was constantly, you know, hearing stories about how you were going about that. You know, because my son was a student in fine arts. And he used to mention about the way, you know, you were working and the way his friends were working. So there was a huge sort of excitement about this work in the Faculty of Fine Arts. So I was also, in a sense, aware of that. And now, looking at it after so many years, was a delight. Why I completely agree with you is also because the only perhaps such other work existing in India is perhaps the door of the assembly building in Chandigarh. You know, where that scale work was really, you know, done as a painting by Le Corbusier, you know. The emphasis or your interest in the cities was your later interest. I think it really came up later. What I was curious about to know from you as a kind of reflection on your own work, I would like to somehow know whether this kind of phase occurred to you earlier of looking at the cities and the excitement that goes with the city. Would you have changed your Bhopal work in relation to the Bhopal city? Because Bhopal city is also one of the oldest grid iron layout, you know, and it has a wonderful life. So I was just curious to know your response as a kind of, you know, reflection on your work, you know, which was done earlier.
No, it's true. I do agree, Mr. Vasavada, that if I had lived in Bhopal, I would have had perhaps different dreams. the dreams that I dreamt in Baroda are dreams of Baroda. So in a sense, life that brings to you, life, you know, in your life, you know, the view that you construe, you know, you imagine first, okay? And then you construe, then you actually put it in some form, other visual form or in another form. There is a passage, there is a journey, you know, that you undertake, you know, and that it assumes a proportion. Sometimes you do not even realize that it would assume that proportion, but it did. In this case, because it came to me, you know, it was a project given to me, and I had to answer the challenges of the project. But the question that you ask, you see, Bhopal painting is not about the city.
Yes.
Bhopal painting is a kind of a reflection upon living in India, or living, in this case, I have quoted Madhya Pradesh because it happens to be in Madhya Pradesh. So I have many images. I know there is an image of Kabir, there is an image of Archandayan, there is image of the particular mosque which is in Bhopal, there is a Ujjain temple, etc., etc. But it was a kind of a bringing together all kinds of images. And the gentleman asked me earlier, and I go back to that we had that material with us. We collected that material for building that kind of a, I was not building a city, I was building a tree. I was building kind of living habitat inside a tree or around a tree or with a tree. And can I tell you that out of the material that we collected for something like 3 months from Madhya Pradesh, photographs, books, journals, you know, interviews with people, everything, 90% of it was thrown away. 90% had to just go out because it was a kind of a literal meaning of the word. Now, we are not, how are we? I mean, if I want to do something worthwhile, I should enjoy it. I should use my imagination. I should use my hand, my body. And in fact, what happened, Mr. Vasavada, is that, okay, I made 3 paintings. I was not sure what I would paint on that scale. So I took the format of that frame, that was 31 feet, but I made six foot. And I made one painting, which I, dreaming of that space, which I had seen in Bhopal. Then I put it aside, I painted another one, and where I again used the idea of a tree, but there I brought the idea of the partition, I brought the idea of not only town, but also the country. That also I put aside. And this was the third one. Mm-hmm. The third one seemed to work because by that time, I had got out of my system. Mm-hmm. I had begun to feel for that space. And I thought that now let me construe something, you know, which comes out of this. Now we did that. Now it is very interesting that there is not a single canvas on which it is painted. I painted it on a single canvas on a small scale. Because I had to see the whole thing. How do I see it? There was no place available in Baroda to display the 31 foot painting. There was no place. And you know what we did? I'm just a side story. Side story is that we could put it up to about 15 feet. And then we put the whole thing on the ground. I walked up a staircase, actually a ladder, which was about 15 feet. and I saw the mural on the floor, where it was going to be originally on the wall. But I saw it the other way around, you know, and I had to decide whether I was doing the right thing. But you have to take the risk. If you don't take the risk, there is no fun. You know, you have to take the risk. I did take the risk. And the third painting in that sense began to make sense to me. I'm not saying that it's a perfect thing. I'm saying that it made sense to me at that particular time. If I were to do the same thing again today, I do not know what I will do. I may not do anything of what I've done because that memory is gone. That time is gone. I cannot rememorialize that time. And that has already resulted into a concrete work. It's not something which is in the manner of writing, but it's actually a work. So,
true.
If I have strayed away from your main question, please answer. I'll answer it again.
No, no, no. I think I just wanted your reflection on this, you know, and I think it was wonderful to listen to you on the process of your work, you know.
So and another thing, let me tell you with regard to architect, it's a space. How do you look at a painting? See, I did a small painting which was 6 foot high, okay, of the same format. But when you stand in front of a 6 foot painting, you are more or less the size, height of the painting, okay?
Yes.
You are 5.5, 5x9, whatever. But you can see the whole painting from top to bottom.
Yes.
Right? When it is 31 foot high, it doesn't remain straight. Where would you stand? Is there a place in the middle where you can stand? No, there's no place for you to stand. So you stand at the bottom. When you stand at the bottom, in a perspective, that rectangle would look narrower at the top.
Rhomboid.
And broader at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you stand in front of it somewhere far away, it's very difficult to find a vantage point.
Yes.
So we had to struggle with that. Now, what was happening that in the small painting, I had done some figures, which looked all right. I had also done some landscape, which looked all right. The moment we enlarged it five times the size, and we put it, let's say, where it was at 3 foot, 5 foot, or maximum 6 foot. When it went to 12 foot and when it went to 15 foot, it changed. It looked different. It did not work. So on the final canvas, it had to be redone. You had to do a new image, a new figure, so that if you are looking at it from bottom, standing in front of it, and if you are looking at it, it should work.
Yes.
This is what we have to sort it out.
Yeah,
sure. Sorry, no, personal level, I thought that I will share this experience.
No, this is always an issue. Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. This was the only thing I wanted to know.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for asking such questions.
No, thank you.
There are some questions from the attendees, and in fact, I'm thinking that there are so many interesting ones that I will ask the attendees to kind of, I'll unmute them and ask them to ask you themselves. Some you have already answered in the previous responses, but I'll let Soumitra ask his question. Soumitra, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Please go ahead.
Soumitra Ghosh. Okay, I don't know if he's, have I done it right? I'm not sure. Okay, I will read out his question. Would you see parts of the memory of the now distant home or village, or town? Yes, Soumitra. Yeah.
Sorry,
would you like to ask your question?
Yeah, I was trying to avoid that. That's why I wrote the question.
But I can,
I can't hear you.
Yeah. I'll read the question. Would you see parts of the memory of the now distant home, village, or town appearing and slowly vanishing as we start living in cities? And new memories of the present start shaping the future and new memories. So do you see that there is a time frame that is fathomable as to how long memories sort of last?
Okay. Shall I answer?
Please, sir.
You see, at one level, what you have said is absolutely right, because the distant memory becomes very distant. And you feel that distance has made it vague, or it really becomes fuzzy, and you think it disappears. That is, at one level, I can answer saying that, yes. But at the same time, you know, in the same breath, I would say that there are what you call recurrent dreams. That nothing in the childhood that you have experienced at a certain level disappears ever. It comes again and again in different forms. Sometimes it sort of produces even an image. Sometimes you find yourself, you know, in a dream. So what I'm trying to say is that both are part of reality and part of life. Because if you were to totally forget whatever happened in your life, what would that life worth be? You know, what kind of a life are you going to? You know, whatever that comes to you, and the storehouse of memory that has those multiply rich experiences, if those disappear from your, you know, world, from your imagination, nobody is more impoverished than you yourself. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that you go back to it. I'm not saying that you nostalgically keep returning to it. Nostalgia can be a problem. I do understand that.
Yes.
But the new life that comes to you, how do you grapple with new life? Every point, every moment in life is a struggle. Every moment a human being struggles for, let us say, you know, the next moment. And that he keeps moving from moment to moment. And in a way, these moments build the world in which you live, and the world that you begin to, you know, recognize and perhaps even give a name to. Mm-hmm. So what is this world that I am living now and the world that I have left behind? It is not kind of a film that I had made of those days. Mm. It's a kind of a living memory. In this, let me tell you, a painting is not a record of what happened. A painting is reliving the experience and recreating that experience. In that sense, painting assumes an identity of its own, you know, right. It becomes an entity by itself. So that entity, there is no need for you to, you know, throw it out of your, you know, whatever life that you are living. But at the same time, you are living this life, and you have now come to live in a city. Let's suppose I have lived in New York, I have lived somewhere else. I live in this city because circumstances have brought me here, and my needs change because I come to different situations, and my needs would allow me to view the world differently. Possible that my views may even counter or contradict the view that I had held earlier. But that's the fun of life, you know, because you you constantly keep revising it. You constantly keep changing it. If you do not change it, if you do not re-look at it, and if you do not revise it, there's no fun in it. So you revise, you redo, and if that comes back to you, and if it is useful to you, you keep it somewhere. And such memories, which are, let us say, powerful memories, which you have of your childhood or whatever time that you have, your first love, your first girlfriend, or whatever, wherever you've been to, all such things would you would like to conserve. And that may remain conserved in your, wherever, in your being somewhere. But at the same time, you construe new world, and according to new world, you construe new realities. And realities assume different meaning. Reality doesn't remain the same. So if, suppose I think it was, my story was that I saw those houses which I had seen in my childhood, literally after almost 30 years. And I began to reimagine and paint them. And when I painted them, I did not see them as they appeared to me, except for a few images here and there, few aspects here and there. But most of it was construed by my mind at that point of time when I was painting it. So similarly today, if I am in a city, as you see the city that I look at, the city of Baroda, that painting doesn't hark back to that painting. City of Baroda has given me a different perspective altogether. I have begun to look at it differently. Like for instance, in City for Sale, there was city built by human images, human beings. You know, I did not use architectural models. In the next phase, I'm using literally some kind of an architecture. I'm building architecture, I'm building house, small, big, whatever, but that is how it. So it would change, and it would, invariably it would change. Have I answered your question, or am I?
Yes, yes.
Missing something.
Very nicely. Thank you so much, and wonderful seeing your work again.
Okay. Anyone else?
Yes, we have Snehal Nagarsheth, and she wanted to ask you a question. I feel you like to see who asks you the question, so I've brought them on as panelists. So I request her to please start her video and ask the question.
Okay.
Sorry, you are on mute. Can you unmute yourself, please?
Okay. Yes, I have unmuted myself. Thank you. It was wonderful to see some of the paintings. I've never lived in Baroda, but it was very interesting to see that I could enter your paintings without having actually lived in Baroda. So in some sense, I thought that the painting of Baroda spoke to me of city, and it didn't matter to me with the specificities that you were talking about Baroda. And in that sense, I thought your painting allowed me to enter knowingly or unknowingly. And I was wondering, how do you feel as an artist when people kind of, so there is an immersion that I can have within that city without really being part of the city. So I was just wondering, how do you feel about it? Do you see it as a universal, or do you see it as a specific?
Oh. It's very difficult to put it down in a singular category, you know, because you see, a city means number of things to number of people, even number of things to a single person. No, because city comes to you in multiple ways. And how you look at the city, how you understand the city. I know when I was painting that painting, I had my associates, you know, the boys and girls who were working with me, and we were looking at the Google Earth and we saw the city, and they all gasped and said, oh, we have never seen our city like this. You know, it's almost like, sorry to use a historical kind of a figure like Petrarch. Petrarch is supposed to have walked on the hill of Fiesole and looked at the city of Florence from there and exclaimed, say, oh, is this the city I'm living in? Now, what I'm saying is that when we looked at that from top, from the satellite, you know, the city, because we look at it frontally, you know, houses are bigger than us. You know, we never fly, we never climb above it. We never see them in that combination, the way in which all, but then what is the city? City had, you know, those beautiful buildings, the colonial architecture, some of the finest, you know, their mind and others had built, you know, University of Baroda, etc. City had so many banyan trees. So environmentally, it was so beautiful. Unfortunately, it has been eroded. Now, city which have many, it was a small university town, now it has become an industrial hub. Which is the city are we talking about? When I came to Baroda, it was a small university town. I could bicycle down the university, all the places. And I used to. I remember there is a road, it's called Yale Road in those days, and then became an Indira Avenue Road. And I used to bicycle from there to Shiabag, from my hostel, you know. And it was so, because entire Yale Road was covered by banyan trees, both sides. There was no sunshine in there. You could see the shadow. And in summer, you know, you could literally go there. Now that city is gone. You know, it's a different city. And the city keeps changing all the time. As I said, that it was never known as, it was a city known for its music. The city was known for, you know, artists like Nandalal Bose and who had come and worked, Ravi Verma had worked. But if city gets identified with communal riots, then it's another city. The same thing, you don't know. How do you articulate that city? It's not a simple definition. There is one little thing that it occurred to us. When my boys and I were looking at it, I said, hey, look at the biggest building in the city of Baroda. Would you find out? And they went back all around everywhere. And eventually, I think what they had in mind, they came with the pat answer, said that it is the palace, the Lakshmi Vilas Palace. I said, okay, let us go around. And we looked at a, you know, satellite map, and there was a building bigger than that. I said, hey, who is that? What is that? You know, and nobody knew about that. And what we discovered, it's quite shocking to find that it was the central jail. Central jail was bigger in, you know, whatever you call it, periphery or litera, than the palace. What does it speak of the city? So you have many definitions. There is no single definition of a city. But each one of us who has lived in the city will have his or her own view and her own definition also. Right or wrong, often you are quite wrong, but we all form definitions. Have I answered your question or do I try something else?
Thank you very much. Yes, you have in some ways managed to talk about it and tell me. Thank you.
Okay, anything more?
We have Brinda. Brinda wants to ask you a question. Brinda, can you please go ahead?
Good evening, sir. That was a really amazing presentation. I actually wanted to ask you, in your painting starting 2011, there's this sense of looking predominantly from the outside or looking down from up. And I think this also ties into your answer that you give Snehal ma'am right now about like this satellite view. Whereas in all your earlier paintings, there was this sense of the inside as well as the outside and the conjunction between the two. So was that a factor of the new technology when Google Maps came about, or was it also some kind of artistic or political statement?
Very interesting question. Yes, I'm very glad you asked. You see, I have always maintained that any image that we know in our life is never seen from one angle, from one point of view. Even a human being, your own friend, you have seen from five different angles around. You have seen him or her from top. You have seen perhaps him lying on the ground, etc., etc. Similarly, houses we never see from top, very rarely, unless we fly kite or do something. But you never go right on the top to see the. That's only when you have this kind of a satellite view. And even the satellite, you know, its eye moves from point to point. You know, it cannot cover everything. It's not the same angle at which everything is visible. Even the eye of the satellite sees it in a multiple angle. Am I clear about that?
Yes.
So you see, what we did was to draw the arteries of the town, city, main arteries, that this is the main, Mandvi Road, and then tower, etc., etc. We did that. So we thought that we have made our basic structure and around which we'll build the city. Now the houses that we painted were painted from multiple points of view. Not a single house, because each house was hand painted. It was not necessarily a copy of a photograph. If you look at it carefully, it's all construed. It's all made right at that moment. If I did it or one of my associates did it and he did it and I approved it, I would say that, well, it's another point, another angle from which you have seen this house. We don't see as the street opens with a photographic view. There's nothing like that. There is a street, of course, and around which are houses, but they are not viewed as though seen from one angle. They are houses which are differently gathered. They are put together, you know, in different, and they are all viewed differently. And hence, you have a kind of a multiplicity, which is perhaps slightly difficult to fathom. If you see the original painting, you may be able to see many things like that. But this was basically the view. And let me tell you one, that this is not something new that I have done. I have learned it from studying Indian painting. And in many an Indian painting, there are multiple views. You know, if you see the pond in a painting, it is seen as though it is seen from above. But if you see the figure nearby, it is seen as though it is seen in profile.
Right.
So how do you put the two together? You know, so multiple perspective is the word which I use, and I have written about it. So if I feel very strongly about it, it would obviously figure in my work. So in a way, these are my hobby horses. And so something that I think, and what we did together was so much more fun than making a copy. Copy dulls your mind. Copy makes you literally a nonsense of your imagination. Copy doesn't allow you to enter anything. If you want to enter anything, you must have something imaginative. Something with each house, if it is something different than the other, then it would allow you to enter it. Anyway, I hope I have answered your question.
Thank you, sir.
We have Timothy Hyman with us, and I would request him to ask his question.
So,
you're on mute, so if you can unmute yourself.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, we can hear you.
Okay.
Hi. Oh, who is there? Who is there? Hi.
Well,
hello.
It was
good to see you.
Very enjoyable.
How good to see you. You have survived such a long session. Hello.
I enjoyed it very much.
Hi.
But I wanted to just throw in a few questions.
Okay, please.
The language that you began to elaborate in Baroda owes a lot to Siena. And we didn't touch on the question of the Lorenzetti connection, as it were, which is common to you, to Sudhir Patwardhan, to Giv Patel, and of course to Bhupen. So that whole question of the Sienese input does interest me very much. And it curiously links with Natadwara. I mean, those two together, I think, would be a helpful addition to the language that people would understand had fed into your language.
Yeah.
And how do you feel about that?
I can put in a word about that if you want. Sure.
Yeah.
Because these architect friends of mine might enjoy that. You see, Siena is a place which has been it has drawn us together, some of us together for so many years, I think decades. You know, I must have discovered it right in 1960s when one of my teachers showed me a painting, Sienese painting of Ambrogio Lorenzetti, a tiny painting, whether now it is called Sassetta or whatever, but that, and I was glued to that, and I thought that if I ever were to ever steal a painting, I will do that. That will be the one I will run away. But that city has drawn us together in such a manner that it has remained part of our being. It's not just simply our imagination or our memory, it's the entire being, you know, has been so much part of the city. You know, it's any city that we see, and every time you see a city which is the planned city or the city which has grown on its own, and I don't know whether city or to what extent Siena has grown, let's say if it is a popular imagination that has made it grow in the manner in which it has, or it's a planned shape, or is it a combination of the two that most cities are? And as I have once written that in Siena, there is the big square, or it's not the right word, it's not a square, you know, it's a kind of a ground, which is like a shell. It's like a shell, and it comes down gradually, and then in front of it, you have the Palazzo Pubblico, that great building in which there are these wonderful paintings, you know, which we have admired. But one thing which I have always felt very strongly about Siena, walking in Siena, is that, you know, you go uphill, you know, it's a city built on hills, and you go uphill and you hold your breath. And when you come to a small square or an opening, you leave your breath. In literal sense, it physically works on you. That as though it is built with the breath, human breath. And what is interesting is that you keep doing it all through, and then you have walked, and then when you come down and you come to the center, and if you come down and you have the grand view of the Palazzo Pubblico, and you have the shell, like whatever you call it, you know, ground on which you see the arm of the Palazzo Pubblico, that is the tower, is like the arm of the clock, as though it's falling on that ground. And as though you don't breathe, you don't speak, you become breathless and you become speechless. And that is something the Siena had left. So this is something, it's not my childhood, but whenever it happened, I think it had not gone. It has remained with me throughout. Have I made sense? Hi, Judith. Hi, lovely to see you sitting. Judith, how good to see you people here. I just sent it by luck. I thought that I'd just let it know. But these are all architects. And Mr. Doshi was there, in fact.
You know? Yes, I
don't know whether he was there today, but this morning he spoke. So I was very happy to come and speak to this group of architects. Thank you, Tim. Lovely.
But I hope the architects know about Ambrogio Lorenzetti and about Natadwara.
I do not know whether they know about it. Yeah. If they ask me, I will send them my article, or I'll send your article, or I'll tell them about your book. They should look at your book.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, welcome, my dear. Lovely to see you. Ah, nice.
So you've been taking questions now for a long time. I think we'll end with one last one, if that's okay with you.
Okay.
Nivedita, would you like to ask your question?
Yes. So thank you for this wonderful talk, sir. So my question kind of originated from your answer to Saumitro's question. So when we're talking about the city of the present and memories of the past and how they are kind of interrelated, I was wondering if you perceive the city of the present to be sort of an accumulation of your memories that you have gathered through different pasts that you have sort of experienced throughout your life. So then is the present that we are living in kind of a complex mix of all our pasts? That was my question, sir.
No. Can you please say what is exactly the question that you are asking?
When you were talking about the city in the present and memories of the past, my question to you was whether you would view the city in the present as an accumulation of various memories that you have gathered throughout the various pasts that you have gone through to get to the current version that you call the present.
Okay, my dear. I'll answer it again. I'll have two answers in a sense to explain what I mean. You see, you can't be deprived of your past. No? How would you forget? If you forget, you are not a human being, perhaps you are something else. That means that you carry with you all your memories, all of us, not me alone. And we constantly see ourselves in interaction with what we see, what we live with. That means the world today is always seen in interaction with what you have lived before. That means whatever you have gathered over the years, perhaps gives you some kind of a, whatever you call it, a vision, an eye, or perhaps a way of looking, which allows you to look at the current reality in a particular manner. That is why you say your perception and my perception differ. Because your past is different than mine. So it's not that we give up on what we have as memory. That's one. The second is that, nobody lives totally in the past. Nobody lives totally in the present. Even if you want to live in the present, you may not be able to give up your past entirely. At least in some measure, it will remain with you. But when you live in the current reality, you perhaps visualize the world as it comes to you. And sometimes, it comes to you like a shock, because sometimes, this world is not something which you had imagined it to be. This is a new, a different world. For instance, suppose if tomorrow Baroda were to totally change into some kind of a, something like part of New York, it will come to me as a kind of a big shock. Though it is assumed, many people think that Baroda should become, and many people think that it should be like Shanghai, or it should be like, but most of us, would find it very difficult to, even just with the idea, very idea of Baroda being replaced by something else that has come from another, another planet, and that comes and change. So what do you do? All your memories are then gone. or it sometimes, you know, it turns into a dustbin. And so what I am thinking is that, yes, there is a city of the future. I do understand. And I think that Le Corbusier thought of the city of future by designing Chandigarh. And I also think that there are other architects who have also, they had dreamt, they dreamt of it. But in the case, as I said, in the case of Le Corbusier, that he was working within a grid, it was the grid that guiding it. And he was working with that. And I'm sorry to say that much of it is a result of the kind of grid which defined the way in which he, he planned the city. I don't know whether the city or the, habitats grow like that. Habitats grow quite differently. Sometimes they break the grid. They totally go against the grid and then produce something which might become quite, may not be acceptable or may not be something, which you think it may not perhaps, there cannot, there, you may feel that there's no reason behind it. Yet, these townships or cities, when they grow, they grow in a manner where you find a certain madness. We have spoken about that. And that madness governs you. I'm not saying that Corbusier was not mad enough. Corbusier was mad enough to devise a city of the kind that he did. But you see, devising a whole city, that means the life of people of a whole city, is a huge responsibility. It is something which is very, very, I will shudder to think of designing everything for one whole city. And if I were ever to do that, I will have to be either some kind of a, I don't know what. So let me give you an example here. Timothy Hyman is here, and we are sitting here and we are talking about, and we talked about city of Siena. Well, there was a place which was ruled by what they called Nove or Nine. It's ruled by the Nine, and that means it was not one person, one king, or one particular whatever source of power, but it was multiple. Secondly, they designed the city, and the city was to be built on a hill, multiple hills. There are so many hills. So this, what you build on top and what you build in the middle, what you build in the, has to be realized in terms of living. It is not in terms of drawing on a drawing board. It is to be actually realized how you would look at it. When I go to Dalhousie, a place in Himachal Pradesh in India, I see that there are many hills. When I go up the hills and I look at things, and I find that even trees I can look at from top, which I rarely do here living in Baroda. So it's an entirely different view of the world that you get. And hence, if the people design their houses or whatever it is, whatever the city or the how it came about, is with a view to knowing how to live with, let us say, at the slope, at the top, and how to negotiate, between the two. Now, what is interesting is this, that in the city, there is this palace, which is a, palace is not the right word, but anyways, even the Soviets used the word palace, this palace of the people, Palazzo Pubblico, that means people's palace. Now, among these, there are these two large murals, and it's called Effects of Good and Bad Governments. And when you see these paintings, for once you realize that you cannot grasp them. Because they are in a room, they are painted on both sides. When they are painted on the both sides, you have to turn around. Every time you look at it, you have to turn. Second, you don't grasp it in a single view, so you have to walk. So the city that is painted by an artist called Ambrogio Lorenzetti, perhaps in the city of Siena, is opening as you walk. And with your walk, I do not know whether he has incorporated living in a hill, that city, as it opens, gradually, literally allows you to enter into the houses of people. You literally see people building a building. There are, you know, builders there on top. You see this somewhere, you know, the dome of the dome of Zibel. And there people are dancing in the street. And there it runs into a kind of a, what you call, farmlands or open lands. And that open land is totally different from the city that you have already traversed. And you find that there are two maxims. One is that city, which is perhaps an ideal city, you know, in which people are dancing in the streets, that you are buying your grocery in a shop, there are horsemen, there are all kinds of people, etc., of that period of time. But at the same time, it is the nature. City is not devoid of the company of nature. The nature is not next door, it is built in. So Ambrogio brings, let us say, city next to nature, or nature next to city. And there you traverse, as you walk, you discover the lands, multiple lands. And then you move into another territory and you see the
which is built into
on the other side, and that painting. So you see good things and the bad things, good government and the bad government, both are. So if I go on, I can talk about that. But I hope I have explained myself.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Tim, have I made sense?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, my dear.
It's been a wonderful, wonderful session, and you've taken us into many different realms and many different worlds within your paintings and with your words. And we really are really grateful to you for sharing all of this with us and with all our viewers.
Thank you.
I think I'm joined by everyone in thanking you and hoping that you would join us for our subsequent talks, which will happen in the days to come. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
आओ जो बसावड़ा साहब
थैंक यू
मरसो पर बात कर
जरूर
फोन पर बात कर सो
हां जी जरूर थैंक यू
आओ जो आई हैव टू गो टू अनदर वेबिनार नाउ
थैंक यू
बट देयर आई एम नॉट स्पीकिंग समबडी एल्स इज स्पीकिंग
ग्रेट
इट्स अबाउट सुरेश जोशी ओके आओ जो